শেখ সাগির আলী ফ্রম মিদনপুর কলেজ অ্যান্ড হুই ইজ গোয়িং টু স্পিক অন দ্য সাবজেক্ট উইথ নিউ টেকনিক্স নিউ মেথড টু মেক দ্য থিং ইজি ফর দ্য অ্যাসপিরেন্টস সো উইদাউট এনি মোর উইদাউট এনি ডিলে আই উড নাই লাইক টু সুইচ দিস ভার্চুয়াল স্পেস টু দ্য কি স্পিকার অফ টুডেজ সেশন শেখ সাগির আলী টু ডেলিভার হিস টক ওভার টু ইউ স্যার
Sir, please unmute your audio, Professor Sheikh Sagir Ali.
Yes. Am I audible
yes.
now?
Yeah.
Yes, sure. Yes.
Okay. Sir, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Bapin Mullik, and thank you, my dear friend and research scholar, Hasan Dawak. I welcome her on this virtual platform. So I have been asked to deliver a lecture on the preparation of NET and SET as well as JRM. So at the very outset, I would like to say that from 2012 onwards, UGC has taken a different step. I mean, they has taken a step to conduct UGC NET exam, CBSE NET exam on the base of multiple choices. And there is no negative marking. So before that, before 2012, there was a challenge to read the text thoroughly in the sense that suppose they ask you a question, what do you mean by objective correlative? 5 marks question. Then you have to write the definition as well as the examples of the objective correlative in a presentable manner, in a beautiful manner. But nowadays, they are asking this question with a different perspective or views. And these are from where this has been taken, from where this term, this coinage or this source has been taken. So there are several multiple types question that give you the sense or give you the idea that you have to read thoroughly in a different perspective. Different means I will explore to the whole session. Wait. Now, first of all, you have to collect the MA syllabus of your own university as well as the University of Calcutta, Hyderabad Central University, Delhi University, Bangalore Christ University, Pune University. That's all. So 5 or 6 syllabus of MA from some central and state university, you have to collect them. You have to collect the syllabus of MA from these state and central universities I have mentioned. Once again, I am mentioning Calcutta University, Hyderabad Central University, Pune University, Bangalore Christ University, and Delhi University. Remember why I am speaking you that these particular MA syllabus are important. I have seen that in these days from 2012 onwards, I have seen that most of the areas are covered, especially on the topic of the syllabus, of the text in the syllabus of these universities. So you have to collect them. These are available on website of the particular university and universities, and of your own university. Now, you don't need to read a lot. You have to read strategically. Suppose you are a NEET aspirant. You are trying to begin with your process. First of all, you have to follow a book. The book I am showing you the picture, The Routledge History of Literature in English. This book, The Routledge History of Literature in English. This is the primary book you have to follow. Why? Because if you open the book, if you go through the book, you will find that several texts are pinpointed and highlighted in such a manner that students will find it beneficial for their study. So follow and see. Suppose I am reading W.H. Auden Consider. Then there is a line from the poem Consider by W.H. Auden. Already they have quoted two lines. Consider this and in our time as the hawk sees it or the helmeted airman. So they have tried, Routledge have tried their best in order to highlight the particular segment or the important areas they want to cover. Number one, so this is your Bible. You should follow the Routledge History of Literature in English from the very beginning to end. And you have to read all the areas covered by this. Number one point. Number two, after reading British literature, you have to follow Indian literature. And what books you should follow on this particular Indian literature? See, there is a book. This is the book. The book is called 10 20th Century Indian Poets. 10 20th Century Indian Poets. Perhaps it costs 50 rupees or 60 rupees. And this book is most important, published from Oxford University Press. This book is most important because here in this book, the contents are totally given as per the UGC NEET syllabus. Okay, they have featured KKN Daruwala, they have featured Kamala Das, they have featured Nisim Ezekiel, they have featured Arun Kulatkar, they have featured Sip K. Kumar, Jayanto Mohapatro, Aurobindo Krishnamay Mehrotra, R. Parthosarathi, G. Patel, A.K. Ramanujan, and others. So, what they have done beautifully is, suppose I am reading KKN Daruwala. They have beautifully given his works, several works, like Under Orion, published in 1970, Apparition in April, and the poems taken from the collection. So, in NEET set question, you will be asked to mention the collection, the poem has been taken from which collection, and the lines. You have to remember the poems, the first paragraph and the last paragraph, and most importantly, some important lines. Okay, suppose I am showing you one poem. Suppose, take this G. Patel's one poem, On Killing a Tree. G. Patel's one poem, On Killing a Tree. So you have to, first of all, you have to read out, G. Patel was born in Bombay, 1940. And his other works include poems, Princess, The Illustrated Weekly in India, How Do You Withstand Body, Writing in India, etc., etc. And most important point is On Killing a Tree. So On Killing a Tree, you have to read out the poem, one page poem. And first two lines and the last two lines are the most important ones. And the important line, like here I have just marked the poem, see. then the matter of scorching and choking in the sun and air, browning, hardening, twisting, withering. So this is the most important line of this poem. So what I am saying is that you have to find out, you have to read out these poems at a glance in a
Hello, sir, excuse view. Me. Excuse me, sir. Very sorry to interrupt you, but there's someone sharing the screen.
That's someone is presenting the screen.
It's okay, sir. Continue, sir. It's okay.
Okay, thank you. So what I'm saying is that you have to read out all these poems, the poems that are given in your syllabus, MA syllabus, as well as the syllabus I have already told you, and read out the poems, collection, sources, the poet's background, all the anthologies in a systematic manner. Suppose one anthology has been taken, published in 1960, next 1969. So chronologically, you have to write out on your notes, and these notes will be your Bible. Whenever you are scrolling on the, you are trolling on your rooftop, on your house's rooftop, or in your house in this lockdown time, during this lockdown, you should follow, you should remember the chronology, the lines, and most importantly, the important explanations of these lines. So for this, you have to, nowadays, the most important thing is you, all of them can access the, can beautifully access all the materials on websites, particular websites. And most of the books are available on the internet site called LibGen, LibGen. Who do not know that, where books are available, most of the free books are available. You have to go through the Google search and you have to find the LibGen, 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 and write the name of the book or the author. You can easily download all of them. So this is the part for Indian literature. Now, one by one, I will tell you each and everything. Listen, suppose I am, wait just a minute. Yes. Suppose I am reading Samuel Taylor Coleridge's Biographia Literaria. Okay. So most of the students in MA, they tried to write their answer and just pick up the whole things in their heart and mind and wrote them on their exam papers. But now the situation has gone changed. You have to understand. Suppose I am reading Samuel Taylor's Biographia Literaria. Then you have to follow the main three important chapters. The chapters numbers 13, chapter number 13, chapter number 14, and chapter number 18. 13, 14, and 18 are most important. Why? The reason is, first of all, you have to read the introduction to Coleridge. Okay. Now, introduction to Biographia Literaria. And the most important thing is the brief survey of the topic Biographia Literaria. I mean, selected portions. Selected portions in chapter 13 of Biographia Literaria, Coleridge makes an important observation on primary imagination, secondary imagination, and fancy. And now see, the experts of NET, they, most of the times, they asked several questions on secondary imagination, primary imagination, and fancy. They will quote you, it dissolves, diffuses, and dissipates. What do you mean by this? And which imagination it refers to? it refers to the imagination that is called secondary imagination. Okay, and what is the difference or the distinction between primary imagination, secondary imagination? Now they will quote you one another line that the I hold to be the living power, prime agent of all human perception. And as a repetition of the finite mind or the eternal act of creation in the infinite I am. Infinite I am. From where it has been taken? It has been taken from chapter number 13, Biographia Literaria, and particularly it deals with the primary imagination. So if you don't go through the text, then you can't understand what is there. So for that, you have to go through the text of Biographia Literaria, and these texts are available on these books. Background prose reading, or you can find the book, English Critical Text, this book, English Critical Text, D.J. Enright and Andres J. Chikera. Chikera's book is most important for these texts like Biographia Literaria, text like Essay on Dramatic Poesy, Preface to Lyrical Ballads, Defense of Poetry, Study of Poetry, and Metaphysical Poets, Keats' Letters, From the Letters by John Keats. So you will get 5 to 6 questions from these critical texts. So what I was telling you, that the definition, the distinction between primary and the secondary imagination. Now listen. Now, as I advance, I can see that there is a distinction between prose and poem. Here in this lyrical ballads, I'm just telling you the biography. Okay, sorry. I'm extremely sorry. The language of poetry and difference from prose. Okay. Now he's saying his views on meter, Coleridge's views on meter. In chapter number 18 of Biographia Literaria, he says meter, according to him, is the necessary check to undue effervescence of emotional language. Okay, so we have to understand that his views on meter, his ideas on objectification, and the role of meter in poetry. So Coleridge's Biographia Literaria, primary imagination, secondary imagination, and how it can be distinguished from prose, and the importance of meter in a poem. So all these things are important. You have to read out categorically in a quite beautiful manner. Okay. Now, suppose if you study the study of poetry, if you go through the text, The Study of Poetry by Matthew Arnold, first of all, you have to read out about Arnold. Arnold's important poems, collections, and his critical writing. Okay. Now, Arnold's role as a critic, this is the most important. And why we should read The Study of Poetry. The very first line of Study of Poetry is the most important one. And this question, I think it appears 2 times on net. What is the very first line of the Study of Poetry? The future of poetry is immense. See, the future of poetry is immense because in poetry, where it is worthy of its high destinies, our race, as time goes on, we'll find an ever surer and surer way. So you have to read out these lines because they are important. And why he has said this? What is the occasion of saying such kind of critical words on poetry? Okay, so you have to see them. And most important question is the touchstone method. What is the touchstone method? And you have to read out that particular paragraph on touchstone method. Okay, and how? What are the fallacious estimates? What are the fallacious estimates? And several questions are being asked on NET, on Chaucer and on Barnes in this text, The Study of Poetry. In The Study of Poetry, you will get questions on Chaucer and on Barnes. Okay, so these are the important aspect of reading critical text. Chaucer has criticized Barnes because of the high poetic seriousness. Though his poems have poetic truth in diction and movement. So he has criticized Chaucer as well as he has criticized Barnes. He lacks the high seriousness of the great classics. Who says this? Arnold. To whom? Chaucer. Where it has been discussed? The Study of Poetry. So this is how you have to read out one by one, step by step. Okay, when you are reading British literature, you have to read out the important ages and periods one by one. Don't jump the gun. And suppose I am reading Easter 1916, I am reading, and it has been written by W.B. Yeats. All of us know when it was published, 1920. What is the genre? War literature. Remember, war literature. What is the perspective and who is the narrator? It is narrated in first person from the perspective of an Irish nationalist, assumed to be a persona of Yeats himself. Okay. And what do we get here? We get the ideas of Irish history, the Easter Rebellion, then 20th century poetry, then all these things are described as a backdrop of this poem, Easter 1916. Now I will tell you the key figures. Who are the key figures? Patrick Pearse was the leader of Irish Republican Brotherhood volunteers, one of the two volunteer groups who took part in the uprising. Before the uprising, okay, Pearse was a scholar of Irish history, including mythology and languages. Then you will understand James Connolly was the leader of the Irish Citizen Army volunteers. Okay, John McBride. Although Yeats glorifies the executed rebels as martyrs, he actually despised John McBride. He calls drunken vainglorious loot, L-O-U-T, in the poem. McBride was known drunk who abused his wife, Montgomery, who happened to be the love of Yeats' life. So all these things you have to understand. Then Thomas McDonough joined Irish Republican Brotherhood volunteers in April 1915. Okay, so key figures in the poem, Patrick Pearse, James Connolly, John McBride, Thomas McDonough. Okay, and now you have to understand the plot summary. Plot means the important lines, the aspect, tone and the meter, and historical figures. Okay, here it says politics as well. And the important quotes are there. I have passed with a nod of the head or polite, meaningless words. And thought before I had done of a mocking tale or jibe. Suppose they quote this line. And thought before I had done of a mocking tale or jibe. Here, not only does the narrator fail to share the rebels of enthusiasm for Irish nationalism, he goes so far as to mock them, telling jibes about them to share a laugh with friends at the pub. Okay, these are the important line. And the most important line, all changed utterly. This is the most important line of Easter. All changed utterly. So you have to remember this important text, important lines. the way the narrator here, the way the narrator previously felt about the rebels changes irrevocably after the uprising, when he, like a majority of Irish, came to respect the rebels' willingness to die for their country. And another important line is, a terrible beauty is born. A terrible beauty is born. Okay, these are the important lines of a text. So this is how you have to proceed. Now I am going to another text. Suppose I am reading out six characters in search of an author. This is written by Luigi Pirandello in 1921. And it come under the genre called comedy or tragedy. Comedy as well as tragedy. So see, here Pirandola wrote directly about First World War in his 1934 novel, Brecci and the War. The male protagonist, Brecci, sees the political convictions, morals and family life challenged by the instability of the world conflict. Okay, so six characters in search of an author reveals the modernist influence in characters' fluid realities, identity, confusion, and debates over the nature and importance of art. The six characters exist as art forms with unchanging stories. They are forced to live out the events of their lives over and over again. Okay, in turn, the characters force the actors and director to confront their own unstable identities. Clear? So here, when I am going to read this text, six characters in search of an author, then you have to read out the theater of the absurd. Okay? Theater of the absurd. And you have to learn Beckett, Pinter, Genet, Ionesco, and all their boundaries. Remember, there are multiple identities in this text. Masks are there, M-A-S-K-S, masks. And more themes in Pirandello's works, suppose self-perceptions are there. You have to remember the characters also. So reception and relevance. What is the reception of this text? Suppose six characters in search of an author opened in 1921 at Rome's Theatre Valley to a controversial reception. Audience members shouted, "Madhouse, madhouse." And this is how they started their question. Tell me the text and their reception. What is the text? The text is, answer is, six characters in search of an author. Okay. So, you have to see the who is the mother here, who is the son here, and who is the boy, who is the little girl. All these characters, stepdaughter, father, mother, boy, all these are there. Father, stepdaughter, mother, son, boy, little girl, director, all are there. And author wrote this preface in 1925. Clear? So in Act 2, we can see that the director, foreman, and the property man set up the first scene, which takes place in the parlor of Madame Pace. Now, they will ask you several questions. Some questions that Act 2 of this text was set on the parlor of Madame Pace. Name the text. If you don't read this, how can you answer this? Isn't it? Now, see. So this is how you have to understand the plot summary, and you can do the plot diagram. Now I will tell you, sir, you are telling several things. How can I get these materials? Now listen, on this world of virtual reality, we can get all the materials on Google platform, Google. If you have a internet connection, then you can find it on the Course Hero. There is a site called Course Hero. C-O-U-R-A-C, course hero, H-E-R-O, hero, course hero. And there is another site that is called Lead Charts, L-I-T-C-H-A-R-T-S, Lead Charts. You will get all the materials beautifully explicated on all the text. Though there are some exceptions, some texts are unavailable, but most of the texts are available there. Lead Charts and Course Hero. Okay, and LibGen, L-I-B-G-E-N, LibGen, where you can get all the books. Now see, after reading British literature, one by one from this syllabus, you have to go through, you have to go to American literature. Yes, American literature. So when we are reading American literature, we have to find out how we should go through American literature. So American Romantic period, 1830 to 1870. So first of all, when I start with Romantic period, American Romantic period, we have to understand the American Romantic period's five characteristics. Imagination, individuality, nature as a source of spirituality, looking to the past for wisdom, and seeing the common man as a hero. Okay? Now see, who are the characters here in this romantic period? The first American romantic authors were, among the first American romantic authors were Ralph Waldo Emerson, Henry David Thoreau, and Nathaniel Hawthorne. Okay? And somehow they will ask you the age of reason, 1700 to 1789. So you have to read out categorically. Who are the romantic writers? Edgar Allan Poe, Ralph Waldo Emerson, David Thoreau, Nathaniel Hawthorne, Walt Whitman, Herman Melville. Okay. These American Renaissance writers could generally categorize into the dark romantics and transcendentalists. And now you have to understand Nathaniel Hawthorne. Suppose I am reading Nathaniel Hawthorne. Okay, so first of all, what should I read? Nathaniel Hawthorne was an American novelist and short story writer. Number one. Number two, his novel, first work, Fanshawe, F-A-N-S-H-O-W-E, published in 1828. He later tried to suppress it, feeling it was not equal to the standard of his later work. Clear? He published several short stories in various periodicals, which he collected in 1837 as Twice Told Tales and later in 1842. Okay? Now see, these are the important aspects you have to remember. Now, we all know that his famous quote, I have not lived, but only dreamed about living. Sometimes UGC experts also ask by placing the quotes, important quotes, and what are the important writing. His writings reflects the negative view of the transcendentalist movement. Now this is another important aspect. Transcendentalist movement. Who is there? Nathaniel Hawthorne. Okay. His four major romances were written between 1850 to 1860. And what are they? The Scarlet Letter. We have all read this. We have all gone through this. Scarlet Letter. It has been featured in MA syllabus. Published in 1850, 1850. Second, The House of Seven Gables, 1851. The Bithdale Romance, 1852. The Marble Faun, 1860. Now you have already seen that. The chronology they will ask you. They will ask you the chronology of the sequence or the sequence of the published one. Now, if you remember only one text, how can you select the chronology? So you have to remember all the year. The Scarlet Letter 1850, The House of Seven Gambles 1851, The Bithdale Romance 1852, The Marble Faun 1860. So this is how you can develop yourself. This is another aspect of reading text, and the most important text is the Scarlet Letter. And remember, people will ask me, sir, should we read all the texts of a novelist or a dramatist or a poet? No. Remember, texts that have been featured in your syllabus, in MA syllabus, you have to read them. Otherwise, don't read other texts. Just only summary, only summary. I mean aerial view. Suppose if I have the opportunity to read Nathaniel Hawthorne, then I will read Scarlet Letter in a synopsis, in a summary or in a synopsis. And I will read out the opening, the ending, the climax, the characters, the important quotes. This is how you can progress or take yourself in a different plane. Okay? And what are the, sometimes they will ask you some short story collection. What is a short story collection? What is a short story collection of this man? Okay, so you have to remember the short story collection also as well. Twice told tale, Moses from an old Mansi. Okay, and then Moses from the old men, a wonder book for the girls and boys. All these are short story collection. Suppose I am reading Hilda Doolittle. Okay, so how can I read this? See, when I am reading Hilda Doolittle, I have to remember American poet, novelist. She's an American poet, novelist. And she published under the pen name called H.D. Hilda Doolittle. Okay. And she served as or acted as the literary editor of Egoist Journal. E-G-O-I-S-T. Egoist Journal. Clear? Her poetry appeared in the English Review and translatic review. Clear? So all these things you have to understand or you have to remember. Now see, Oread, O-R-E-A-D, Oread, one of her earliest and best known poem in 1919 under the name D-Imagist. So suppose one question is there. Who is the writer of Oread under the name D-Imagist? So you have to you have to read and you have to understand these things clearly. Okay. So this is how you can take yourself in a different perspective. Her poem, Helen in Egypt, is an examination from feminist point of view of male consent epic poetry. Clear? Herman Melville, 1890-1891. Herman Melville's major works are there. Typee, Omu, Margi, White Jacket, Moby Dick. Suppose people will ask you, what is the subtitle of Moby Dick? Is the subtitle is Moby Dick or the Whale, published in 1851. What is the first line about Moby Dick? All these are things you will be asked. So you have to remember these four important works, Typee, Omu, White Jacket, and Moby Dick. Okay, though there are Billy Bird also there, Billy Bird, Seor, the unfinished work. So you have to read out all these texts in a graphic manner. I mean, just a summary. Beginning, ending, summary, climax, important lines, sources, and characters. Then you will understand the very concept of nowadays name. Earlier, questions were asked on the concept of things. Now these concepts are asked in a question-answer manner. Okay. And the information and the sources, the important lines. So this is one part. And in the second part, you have to collect the 10 years, 15 years previous questions and solve them all. Then we'll get the idea how it works. Number three. See, 20% questions are asked for all the students. 20%. And 30% questions are asked for mediocre students. Sorry, average students. So total 50 and 50%. And in this 50%, 30% are too steep and 20% are below the steep level. So you have to don't bother about all the questions. How can I solve this? This is unknown. This is unknown. This is unknown. You have to understand that I need not work on or think on all the questions. You have to perform. You have to tick mark only 60 to 70% answers and others on the basis of guesswork. Guesswork. Either A or either or C. Remember, A or C, not anything. A or C. Think of your God, think of your parents and tick A or C. Or sometimes it most of the difficult questions answer. It's my opinion, according to me, comes on A or C or sometimes D. So you have to remember, you have to completely performed well on the 50% question, 45 to 50. If you do so, then you can easily comes out of the maximum hurdle and you are on the second step of the most competitive zone. And in this zone, you have to guess the questions, 20 question guess on the basis of your knowledge. And if you can do 10 questions right, then you will clear net. Then forget 40%. So 60%, if you get 60%, you will automatically clear net. If you are under general category, forget about the other categories. Okay, so this is the basic criteria. Collect your syllabus. Read pinpointingly or categorically, graphically, collect the previous year's question and solve them, and read Indian literature, Australian literature, American literature, as well as European literature. Okay, see, and for this book is most important. I will suggest all the NET aspirants to collect the book called Literature in English pre-1914, written by Tony Mears, Literatures in English pre-1914 by Tony Mears. And another version is available post-1914. So the essentials of literature is the most two books and most important books for NET. Why? Because you see, they have already given what I have told you. They have already given the summary, important lines, sources, and all these things are there. So this is the most important book. Another book I will tell you for theory, contemporary theory and cultural, contemporary literary and cultural theory, from structuralism to eco-criticism by Pramod Kenaya. So this is a very important book for the beginners of literary theory. Okay. And another thing I will let you know, for if you are reading history of literature, apart from Routledge Companion to History of Literature, you can follow this book, A Short History of English Literature by Pramod Kenaya. A Short History of English Literature. Here, Professor Pramod Kenayar, has given the graphic view of the periods and the works in a beautiful manner. Post-colonial Shakespeare, rereading Renaissance, literature of the Romantic Ages, all these things are there in a beautiful manner. So you can follow this book also. Another book you can follow. This is the book, P.S. Chakraborty, Anthem Dictionary of Literary Terms. Why? Because here in this book, you will get the gist of the gist of all the terms. Suppose, what do you mean by Hebraism and Hellenism? Who coined the term? Who coined the term womanism? All these things are there. So the gist materials you should understand. And you'll get all these things are there. Deconstruction. Then you'll get the key points. The most important feature of this book is the key points. Poetic license, rhetorical irony, rhyme, and reader response criticism. Who has coined the term reader response? Who are associated with the different schools? Now I have remembered another thing. You need not read all the theory. You will be asked 4 to 5 questions from literary theory or 3 questions. So suppose they will ask you, see the book. This book is written by Raman Seldon, A Reader's Guide to Contemporary Literary Theory, published from Pearson. See, this book here, they have divided the schools, Russian formalism and the Bakhtin school. And the people are Jacobson, Skolsky, the structuralist theories. Who are there? Marxist theories. Who are there? Okay. Feminist theories. Who are there? All the people's name and their works are categorized under different schools. And post-colonial theory, post-modern theory. Suppose people will ask you, Jean Francois Lyotard, his important works. Then if you read, post-modern theory, this is by Jean Francois Lyotard. He's from post-modern aspect or post-modern arena. John Baudelaire. So all these things you have to, all these schools you have to remember and their works and the writers. Number 4, another book you can follow only the aerial view, the book by Cam Newton, 20th Century Literary Theory. Here you will find the important essays or the important title of the works of these critics. Suppose one question maybe like this: who is the writer of Art as Technique, and under which school? Now, Art as Technique is written by Viktor Skolsky, Russian Formalism, and Prague Structuralism. And suppose they will ask you another: who is the writer of Structure, Sign, and Play in the Discourse of the Human Science? Jacques Derrida. And these are the common texts. But problem occurs when they will ask you Raymond Williams, Dominant, Residual, and Emergent, concept of the dominant, residual, and the emergent. Who is the founder of these terms? Raymond Williams. Okay? And Linda Hutcheon's theorizing postmodern. So different Helen Sixus conversation. Different schools are there. So you have to just remember the schools and the writers and their texts and just go into the text in brief or in summary. So that you can understand that, yes, this is the important thing. Clear? Now see, apart from theory, I have already discussed the Indian literature theory and the different aspects of history of the British literature, American literature. Now you can see that, in just a minute, you can practice as much as possible from the book called Ivan K. Massey, an objective approach to English literature. Ivan K. Massey. Here several objective questions are there and answers are there. So the most important thing, you have to practice yourself. Practice with the questions and answers. The more you practice, the more you learn. Whatever you will get in your hand, you should learn. Okay. Now see, suppose, just a minute. Suppose I am reading linguistics. Okay, suppose I am reading or going through the text, basic concepts and theories in linguistics. So how should I begin? I should begin with the methods of teaching English language. The methods of teaching English language. ELT, the grammar translation method, the direct method, the audiolingual method, the silent way, total physical response, grammar translation method. All these things are there. Then you have to understand the major works of I.A. Richards. What are the major works of I.A. Richards? Coleridge and Imagination, Science and Poetry, Basic in Teaching in East and West, Interpretation in Teaching, Basic Rules of Reason, Practical Criticism, 1929. Okay. W.K. Wimsatt, most of the times they will ask questions on intentional fallacy, affective fallacy from the verbal. It appeared on the essay called Verbal Icon, 1954. Okay, why it is called so, and the vowel consonants. Clear? Then will come research methods in English. Research methods. They will ask you several questions on hypothesis, steps in conducting research in English. Okay. And linguistic research, suppose classroom-based research, cognitive linguistics, okay, and corpus linguistics, learner autonomy, prosody, psycholinguistics, second language acquisition. What do you mean by SLA, second language acquisition? Stylistics, sociolinguistics, quantitative research in linguistics. Quantitative linguistics, I mean the short form is QL. Okay, so you have to remember all these things. And in a miscellaneous manner, you have to read and note down the periodicals, the Edinburgh Review, Quarterly Review, Blackwood Magazine, and then Avant-Garde, I mean the important avant-garde involvements, Dadaism, Epic Theatre, Expressionism, Imagism, Surrealism, Theatre of Cruelty, and Serialism. Okay? And you have to also remember the Chartist movement or the Chartism, 1838. And what are the six demands of this Chartist movement? Votes for all men, equal electoral districts, abolition of the requirements, members, payment of MPs, the secret ballot. All these things you have to remember. And the Reform Act, 1832. Okay. 1832. Bible. Chapter 5, you have to remember the Bible. John Wycliffe. Okay. Types of satire. How many satires are there? And the examples of Horatian satire. The Rape of the Lock Pope. Animal Farm, George Orwell. Northanger Abbey, Jane Austen. Brave New World, Aldous Huxley, The Medal and MacFlagno, John Dryden. All these are Horatian satire. Okay, juvenile satire, A Modest Proposal by Jonathan Swift is a example of juvenile satire. The Lord of the Flies, Gulliver's Travels. Okay, so Menippean satire, Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland. And you have to remember types of rhyme. Rhymes mean exceptional, suppose, coverlet, and meeting. Broken rhyme, chain rhyme, cross rhyme, dialect rhyme, disyllabic rhyme, end rhymes, feminine rhymes, forced rhymes. All these things you have to just, I'm not saying that you have to remember all these things. Just have some aerial view. Okay. Now see, masculine rhyme, rich rhyme, triple rhyme. And now you have to understand the types of comedies. Restoration comedy, comedy of manners, artificial comedy, anti-sentimental comedies from 1660 to 1710. And just like a George Thales love in a tub, the comical revenge, all these are the past restoration comedies. Okay, now sentimental comedies like Richard Stills, The Conscious Lover, Kole Sibbas, Love's Last Shift, George Farquhar's The Constant Couple, then comedy of humor, comedy of menace, comedy of menace. People will get question from the term, who coined the term comedy of menace? Arvind Wardell, from the subtitle called of the Compton's play, The Lunatic View, Comedy of Menace. The Lunatic View, Comedy of Menace. Arvind Wardell. Okay, so comedy of menace is the act of threatening or danger. What are the examples? The Birthday Party, Harold Pinter's Caretakers. All these are the examples. Dark comedy, black comedy, like Lawrence Stern's Tristram Shandy. Okay, blue comedy, like The Miller's Tale in Canterbury Tales. Okay, The Miller's Tale in Canterbury Tales is a very good example of blue comedy, in which carpenter's wife and daughter is seduced sexually. That is what is called ribaldry or blue comedy. Remember, ribaldry or blue comedy. What is this? Now, this comedy is sexual in nature, where sex is presented in ribald material for the purpose of poking fun at the foibles and weaknesses that manifest themselves in human sexuality, rather than to present sexual stimulation. Ribaldry may use sex as metaphor to illustrate some non-sexual concern. So blue comedy was coined by Max Miller. Okay, now you have to understand types of theater: epic theater, dialectical theater. Who coined the term epic theater? Erwin Piscator. Epic theater was primarily proposed by Bertolt Brecht in Germany. Okay, then epic theater was a theatrical movement in the early 20th century. The members associated with it are Erwin Piscator, Vladimir Meskovsky, and Bertolt Brecht. Okay, clear. Now Brecht preferred the term dialectical theater rather than epic theater. So you have to go through these important aspects. Theater of the absurd. Now you have seen already that in NET, NET experts will ask you, who is not among this group of theater of absurd? I mean, odd man out. See, Samuel Beckett, Waiting for Godot. Eugene Ionesco, the bald soprano. George Jenet, the maids, the balcony, the screens. Harold Pinter, caretaker, birthday party. Tom Stoppard, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Frederick Durand. Edward Elby, The Jew Story, A Delicate Balance. Badal Sarkar, Ebom Indrajit. Arthur Adamov. And now I will discuss theater of cruelty. So all these things are, you have to learn. Theater of the oppressed at the forum theater. Micro teaching, mecha theater, pantomime, and the list of important odes. List of important odes. Dejection and ode, on duty, imitation of immortal worship, ode to winter, ocean and ode, and list of important sonnets, Tottle's Miscellany, Astropel and Stella, Spencer's Amority Sonnets, Diana by Henry, Constable, Delia, Samuel Delia. Okay, list of important Booker Prize winners. You have to remember the list and you have to make it yourself. In 2000, forget. See, and the next part is Man Booker International Prize. Nobel Prize winner literatures, in list of important Sahitya Academy Award winners. So all these things you have to remember. So my dear NET aspirants, first of all, you have to collect the MA syllabus, what I have told you, the name of the universities. Then the important text in gist or in summary. Then you have to remember the important lines, sources, the climax, Suppose you are reading a text called Who is Afraid of Virginia Woolf? And there are three parts. What is the climax part? What do you mean by the exorcism? What is the appearance? What is the reality? Who are the characters? What is the last line? What is the first line of Bleak House? Important lines. So then you will easily clear net. Don't think about, and whatever you get in your hand, you have to read them. And there is a book called World Literature. World Literature, you can easily get this book. World Literature in your fist, F-I-S-T, an assortment of English literature by Prem Shankar Pandey. Prem Shankar Pandey. This book, this PDF is of 741 pages. 741 pages. 741 pages written by Prem Shankar Pandey. This is the most important book for the glimpse, for an aerial view of literature. So I think I have done all the aspects of or the parts of taste of this test called NEET and GRF. And this book is also written, edited by me, Literary Theory, published by Atlantic. You can see this if possible. And thank you very much for your listening and presence. Now over to Bapin.
Yeah. So very wonderful session, I think, and it is very fruitful. It will be very fruitful for the aspirants of NEET and SET. Professor Sheikh Sagir Ali has emphasized on MA syllabus of different universities. You have to collect from the internet. He has also mentioned the book, The Routledge History of Literature in English, for exploring British literature. That will be very helpful for you. And at the same time, he has mentioned 10 20th century Indian poets, which was published from Oxford. That book will be very helpful for exploring the part of Indian literature, English literature. And he has also mentioned an important website, which is very crucial, LibGen, from where we can collect various books, various e-books. And he has mentioned romantic theory of imagination, fancy, primary imagination, secondary imagination, all these things, and how to explore those things he has explored in this lecture. And at the same time, he has mentioned the book which is very crucial, which is very important for NEET SET. Yes, English Critical Text by DJ and Wright. Professor Sheikh Sagir Ali also mentioned Isra 1916 by Yeats, six characters in search of an author in order to give you an overview and in order to understand how to explore, how to read NEET or SET, how to clear it, how to crack it. And at the same time, he has also mentioned how to explore non-British literature like American literature, Australian literature, Colombian literature, and or other non-British literature in general. And while discussing on American literature, he has mentioned Transcendental Movement, American Romanticism, and the writers like Emerson, Hawthorne, Whitman, Thoreau, and so on. And at the same time, he has also mentioned, short story collection, that particular genre that you have to understand. And another important technique he has shared with us, that is a 20% quotient for all students, right? And 30% for average, and 40 and 50%. That will be very crucial in order to crack the NEET. So you have to remember all those things. And at the same time, he has also mentioned on another important thing, that is how to guess, right? A or C, some important questions are generally, those options are A and C, he has mentioned, and some cases for also D at the same time. This is very important, I think. This is a very good technique. he has mentioned in this lecture. And at the same time, he has mentioned literature in English, 1940, post-1940. And for the study of literary theory, he has mentioned the book Literary and Cultural Theory from Structuralism to Ecocriticism, which is written by Pramod K. Nair. And another book, A History of English Literature, which will be very crucial for the aspirants to explore British literature in general. And at the same time, Professor Ali has also mentioned Anthem Dictionary of Literary Terms, written by P.S. Chakraborty. And at the same time, A Reader's Guide to Contemporary Literary Theory by Roman Seldon, and 20th Century Literary Theory. And at the same time, he has also mentioned some important books like An Objective Approach to English Literature, published by K.K. Narayan, Om Prakash, and so on. Now this lecture, this session is open for all the aspirants who want to raise any question. They can turn on their mic, or they can comment in the chat section. So it is open to all. Dear participants, if you have any questions, then you can turn on your audio and then you can raise the question. Hello? Professor Ali will answer.
Yes, hello, I have a question. Can I speak?
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Am I audible to you, sir?
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
Okay, sir. I would like to one question, right?
Sure.
I am Barsha Bishai, student from Department of College, Betai. Sir, can I sit it now? Or I shall start my master resource, sir, which should be better for me.
I can't hear you properly. Can you please repeat? It is getting disconnected. Some aberrations are there. Can you please repeat?
Yes, sir. So
please write your question on the chat box. Okay,
yes,
we can't hear you. So please write your question on the chat box. Thank you. Next one is
sir, I have a question. Can I speak? Yes, I'm Mohita Roy. I did my MPhil from Bortman University. Sir, due to network problem, I missed the initial part of the lecture. So I just want to know, is there any way out that I can go back to the video, as far as you know, whether this will be posted in Facebook or YouTube or something or not? I just need to know that.
No,
I think you should answer this.
So, Boisaki, you can see that in the chat box we have shared our YouTube channel. Okay, the link you can.
Yes, I have already subscribed.
Yes, if it is possible, we will upload it tomorrow or after 2 days. Okay. So whole the lecture will be on his YouTube channel. So from there you can get all the information. Thank you.
Okay, and I also want to say thanks, sir, for such elaborate and all inclusive discussion that includes all the topics and aspects that NET exam, you know, is about. I thank him genuinely, and I also want to know if there is any question or if there is any problem or regarding NET examination, any topic oriented question, can I contact sir, or is there any way that I can reach out to him or contact him if I want to?
Yeah, this is a very difficult question. I am available on Facebook, as well as I have 2 WhatsApp group for NET SET, and this is absolutely free, where I distribute all the PDF materials, and all the materials are there, and two groups are full. So you can be there, and you can join me on Facebook, where you, if any problem arises, you can ask me. If I have the time, I will assist you. Thank you very much. Next question.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Myself, S.V. Choudhury. I'm a NET aspirant. And thanks, first of all, to all the members, and especially to you for giving us, or for sharing such important and informative things with us. Actually, I have missed, the same problem occurs to me. In initial sections, I have missed out some of your lectures and the suggestions of the books that you have provided. That's why if somebody can please write down the names of the books serially one by one, then it's okay, possible
as,
for me.
Listen, as Bapin said, it will be available on YouTube. I hope you will get it. So don't worry.
Okay, sir. This is one thing. And second thing is, sir, I'm already there in base literature group. If you somehow allow us to get the PDFs of the books that you mentioned to that base literature WhatsApp group, then it's very much easy for us.
Okay, I will try.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Good evening, sir. This is Abhinav here. Can I ask a question, sir?
Sure. Go ahead, Abhinav.
Sir, so I have this question. Since you mentioned that, you know, there are only maybe 3 to 5 questions from literary theory in the NET exam.
Yeah. Yeah.
So is there a possibility that we can exclude it entirely and then go about real hard as far as the other topics are concerned?
See,
because it's a huge thing to cover.
1 + 1 = 2, and 1 + 1 + 1 = 3. So everything counts. Remember, each and everything counts. I am not saying that you have to be Derrida, you have to be an expert on literary theory, but learn somehow important lines, the different schools, who are associated with the schools, the important essays, important dictum, logocentrism, phonocentrism, who has coined this, affective fallacy, intentional fallacy, all these things.
And Yes. So are there any, like, maybe 3 or 4 schools that we can, you know, go about very, I mean, in a detailed manner and maybe skip some of the others? Can we have an option as far as some of the schools are concerned? For example, say, psychoanalysis, or say, structuralism or Marxism?
No, there is no shortcut to success. You have to, one of my friends, Sanchoita, she just messaged me that, apart from your lecture, you should mention one thing, that hard work and dedication is the key to success. If you read 6 hours a day, you have to read and dedicate yourself for 6 hours a day, then you will get NET. And 10 hours a day, you will get GRF automatically. And now the future is in your hands.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. And I really like to thank you for the amazing service that you've been doing. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Welcome. Next question.
Hello, sir. I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, I am saying that you told us that the qualifying percentage of NET is 50% to 60%. So what is the percentage to crack GRF?
Most of the time, GRF in general category. General category, GRF goes 60% to 64%. 60% to 64%. And in OBC category, 57% to 62%. In SC category, this is the highest. In SC category, 52% to 58%. So it may vary, but this is the normal procedure.
Okay, sir. Okay, and sir, how many students in general get the GRF?
I don't know, dear. These are the I have somehow learned that 6% possibly. 6%. But this is a different question. It will be better answered by the UGC members. I don't know, but think of yourself, nah. Don't think of other things.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your enlightening lecture. Thank you, sir.
Next. Do you have any other question? Then please let me know. Otherwise,
hello, sir.
Yes. Go ahead.
Yeah. I have just one question. Can you tell me some of the key points of differences between preparing SET and preparing NET? Number one. Number two, the second question that I would like to ask, can you give us some tips and tricks for mastering this section of this NET that is called contemporary literature?
Okay. See, first of all, nowadays, we can see that SET are stiffer than NET. NETs are more easier than SET. So try to crack NET, not SET, because SETs are difficult in terms of West Bengal. Maharashtra SET, UP SET, they are very easy. I have seen the question. But West Bengal SET is too stiff. So try NET, not SET. Number one, and there are no differences in terms of question. And the second question, how to master the contemporary literature? So in mastering this, you have to find out the syllabus of these four or five university, Pune University, Calcutta University, Hyderabad Central University, and Delhi University, and as well as of your own university, and see the post-colonial literature, contemporary literature, and just find out the text in literature or in precise materials. Just have some aerial view and note down the words. I hope it will work. Next.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes, I have another question.
Okay. Sure, go ahead.
Sulekha, please go
Hello,
ahead.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir. I am Sulekha Baske, student of Minapur College Autonomous. Sir, I have a question that what are the other aspects of fields after clearing the NET or SET with GRF?
What are the?
Fields after clearing NET or SET with GRF.
Yes, if you clear GRF, then you will get assistantship or fellowship for your research work. I mean, you will get money from government for your research work if you clear GRF. And if you clear NET or SET, NET is valid all over India, colleges all over India, and SET is valid for the colleges all over West Bengal or in states, concerned states. And then you have to appear for the interview or the Viva for College Service Commission or any other interviews. Next question. Yes, there is another question from Borsa Vishas. Wait, just a minute. Borsa Vishas. I am now an undergraduate student, sir. Can I start reading about SET and NET now? Or I shall start this reading after my master's degree? If you say so, sir, I would be better. Borsa, listen. Don't try to buy panic. Read at your own time, at your own leisure. But while reading, you have to proceed categorically in a scientific manner. First of all, source, then genre, other works of the writer, important lines, first line, last line, climax, important questions, terms. All these are most important. Then you will hopefully clear NET easily. Next question.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. It's a wonderful lecture, really.
I hope there are no one to ask me question. Bapin?
No, sir, yeah. I have only one question, sir. Sir, there is this conception, it might be a misconception as well, which you can clarify. So while we prepare for NET, there is this idea that we need to put more emphasis on British literature than the non-British part, say European and literary theory and other things. I mean, how far is this true? I mean, from your lecture, I got the idea. It is clear to me that we have to read everything, and we have to
have
a basic idea and understanding of all the topics. But
yes,
if I ask you, as far as you know, I mean, majority is concerned, can we say or do we hope that most of the questions are asked from British part, or 30% or 40% questions are asked from British part? Is there any division like that?
Yeah, good question. Very good question. Now let me tell you. Since we are the students of English literature, we are the students of English literature. So English literature is the primary thing, primary area. They will ask you questions broadly from English literature, from Shakespeare, from Chaucer, from Eliot, from metaphysical poet, from Golding, from 20th century writers. Apart from, 40% question. 40 to 45, not more. Remember, only 40 to 45% questions they will ask you from British literature. And other parts, 55% questions will be from American literature, European literature, Indian literature, linguistics, culture studies. All these things are there.
Okay, thank you so much.
There is another question from Madhumita Udrima Chakraborty. She is asking, sir, will you please elaborate surrealism with expressionism?
See, expressionism is a, though both are somehow related, but surrealistic concepts are the haphazard ideas, the portrayal as presented by the artist on that child. These are concepts, these concepts are established with the ideas came from Dadaism, Surrealism, and Expressionism. Though both of them are somehow related, but they are distinct. Next question.
Any other question? Hello.
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Sir, this is Shrimanti.
Yes, go ahead.
Am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Sir, while preparing the Victorian, age, what are the main parts we should put more emphasis on?
See, there is no hard and fast rule to prepare the Victorian age. While preparing Victorian age, you have to remember Tennyson, Browning, Hopkins, and the writer specially apart from Tennyson, Browning, you have to remember the Aurora Aurealis, the writer, I'm just forgetting the name. So these are the most important writers in Victorian age is syllabus. If you find in your syllabus, you will get the names of the writers prescribed in there. So no need to be panicked on this Victorian age. Rather than, you should concentrate on overall on Romantic, Victorian, Modern, and the early moderns.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir. I am Abhay Agwan. Hello, sir. I am audible.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, please go ahead.
Yes. I'm calling from Kolkata. So, can you explain what is aporia, sir?
Aporia is a kind of impasse. Suppose in a text, there are some ideas that are implied, that is not clearly expressed. So these impasses are called aporias. Okay. So if you say some modern text, you will find some ideas are implied by putting some comma, some triple dots or some brackets. So these things are generally called aporias. So you can find it, you know, in your broadly in the critical terms books. Okay, next question.
Any other questions that you want to raise?
I think there is no other question.
Yeah.
There is no other question, right?
Hello, sir.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I have one last question to the base literature group. If anybody can allow me, please.
Just a minute. So since that boy was asking me on aporia, I want to mention another thing on this aporia. Aporia is a kind of conventionally the term means a phase of a sense of dilemma. It's a kind of dilemmatic condition. Suppose in Hamlet's famous speech, to be or not to be, that is a dilemmatic condition. It's a kind of aporia. In deconstruction, the term is frequently used in the theory called deconstruction. Here, the term is frequently used to indicate an impasse or the what I've said earlier, impasse or interpretative dilemma that makes it impossible. Clear? Or seemingly impossible for the reader to interpret meaning. Aporia stands for the gap, what I've said earlier, the gap between what a text says and what is believed to mean. Text ki bolche aur ami ki bishwas korchi. It forms the crux of Jacques Derrida's theory of difference. Next question.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Can I ask? I have qualified late for 2 times. So, what should I do now?
You have qualified 2 times. If you have qualified 2 times, Nate, now you should prepare for College Service Commission interview for Viva by picking up 3 authors from different ages or period, and by picking up 2 genres, suppose novel, suppose poetry or postmodernist novel or modern novel, or 3 authors. Suppose one is Thomas Hardy, another is Tennyson, another is Browning or T.S. Eliot, and all the works of T.S. Eliot, and 2 or 3 poems of T.S. Eliot, or 1 important text. Next question.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, as we have got a notice that from next year we have to undergo a PhD degree, otherwise we'll not be able to sit for CSC.
I understand. PhD degree, as far as my knowledge is concerned, PhD degree is for the person aspired to be in the university, not in colleges, as far as my knowledge is concerned. So you need not to be worried.
Sir, to get admission in PhD, what should I do now?
You have to pick up 1 research proposal with some research questions that are genuine. Research question in a research proposal is a must. 3 research questions, not more. And you have to look whether earlier these works have done or not. Suppose you can work on the environmental issue, but it has been done. But you have to pick up in a different manner. Suppose dystopia and environment. So you have to think of your own space fiction. Dalit, okay, Muslim, etc. Okay, next question.
Sir.
I think this is your last question.
Yeah, go.
Sir,
ahead,
how
go
to
ahead.
Prepare for interview in CSC or PSC?
Yeah, that's a very good question. For preparing or taking preparation for CSC or interview? CSC preparation, na?
CSC or PSC, assistant professorship.
Yes. Okay, no problem. See, in College Service Commission, they will ask you for 5 minutes demonstration. So you have to select three texts, three author. Suppose namely William Wordsworth, next T.S. Eliot, next Ted Hughes, or any other. And when they will ask you to give a demo on certain author's work, any particular work, then you have to prepare, you have to make sure that you have beautifully prepared your one work of each work, not each work, important works of these authors. And at the same time, you have to take preparation of three genres: poetry, novel, drama. Not three genres, sorry, I'm extremely sorry, you have to take preparation of any one genre. Okay. Suppose I'm interested in novel, then he will ask you Victorian novel, modern novel, postmodern novel. They will ask you in which age you feel is. Then you should answer, sir, I feel comfortable in the period called Victorian age. They will ask you Victorian age, different questions on Victorian age. They'll ask you, if you say postmodern, they will ask you postmodern text, what you have gone through, two texts, important lines, and most important, remember, most important is the reference book. Reference book, suppose you are saying, you are giving a demo on Thomas Hardy's Tales of the D'Urbervilles, then they will ask you, my dear friend, tell me what are the recommended texts, recommended books, they will, if you want to recommend to your students. For your MA students or BA students. So recommended texts are most important thing. And for PSC, they will ask you genre. They will ask you particular text you have gone through. Important line, important meaning. Suppose you have gone through the text, the rhyme of the ancient mariner. They will ask you, what is the genre? What is the important line? What is the concluding line? What is the meaning of it? What perspective should you take to make some relevance with the present situation before your audience, before your students? These are the things they will ask you. And the recommended text. And when you say, I have read this book, I have gone through this book by Julian Wilfrid, Introduction to Literary Theory, then they will ask you, what is the first chapter? What is the last chapter? Have you gone through it or not? So these are the questions they will ask you. Next question.
Sir, is there any time limit for the demonstration?
5 minutes.
5 minutes. Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, I just have a small query.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so may I go ahead or someone else?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so sir, I just have a small query. Is that after like cracking GRE, MPhil candidates also get the fellowship money from the government, or it is only for after you enroll for PhD?
No, MPhil as well as PhD candidate, if you have GRF, MPhil candidates as well as GRF candidates will get the fellowship. But once you enrolled in MPhil, you will not get the fellowship in PhD. Remember.
So it won't be continued for like 5 years.
No,
No. I must confirm that. Yes, you can. If you have.
Yeah, JRF to SRF, right?
Yes, oh, you can transfer it JRF to SRF.
JRF to SRF.
So you can continue. Duration of the MPhil and PhD must be within, I think, 11 months. Okay.
So there is a rule. Thank you for correcting me. So you can transfer it from junior research fellowship to senior research fellowship.
Yeah.
Okay, so all I have to do is just to update the status, right?
Yeah.
Okay. By like just through an application.
Yeah, there are proceedings are there. You can inquire into the department and they will let you in. They can make sure.
Okay, so the fellowship as a whole, it is for like 5 years, no more or less than that. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir, there is a...
Hello?
Hello, sir.
Hello?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
I think there are 3 questions are there. So, Murshid Alam, please go ahead. After that, Neha, and final, the last one, Mujibur Rahman.
Okay.
Sir, please take my rest. I'm deeply moved by your lecture. You are like encyclopedia.
I can't hear you. Can you please speak a bit loud?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello, sir. Actually, please take my respect. It was a very nice presentation. I was deeply moved. Okay, you are like encyclopedia. Thank one. You. And really true to say that, I would like to say that how can you collect so many information in such a way that you can present it so instantly? And actually, it needs a lot of study. And I my question is that how can I to make collect those information from English literature so that I can as well present such a way, great way? What should be the beginning and how to continue?
There is no beginning and ending, dear. You have to start someone, somewhere, from somewhere. And what are the books in your hand? Start from them. There is no beginning, no ending. Start now. And what are the books at your hand, at your disposal? Start with them.
Neha, please go ahead. Your question.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir.
Neha, go ahead.
Sir, I just want to ask one question. Can you please explain cultural feminism?
Cultural?
Feminism. Sir, actually, this may be the different from this lecture.
What? Cultural?
Feminism. Cultural feminism.
Cultural feminism. So, feminism, cultures are represented in a feministic way. The feminist perception of culture. In a broad manner, these feminists, they have tried to bring out the perspectives of culture in their arena called feminism. Suppose there are different genre called Islamic feminism. There are different genre called, eco-feminism. So it's a cultural feminism where the different aspects of culture are attributed, or you can say entangled within the arena of feminism. So feminist perspectives and culture go hand in hand. And they can exacerbate in a different perspective in such a way that will create an effect in the mind of the man. Next question.
Mujibur Rahman, please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Assalamu alaikum, sir. Hello, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Go ahead.
Yes, sir. There is a big problem of mine. I don't know what you are going to think about it. But my problem is that I got too much confused with the name of the writers, authors, and the critical thinkers, etc. Each and every time, whenever I'm just collecting a new name of a new authors, and afterwards I'm just keeping to another one at the time, so I just immediately forget. And after all, if I try to remember them, I get confused about two or three authors.
Okay.
What should I do?
Do you hear Hindi songs? Yes or no? Do you listen Hindi songs? If yes, then how can you remember Hindi songs? The repetition of the sound again and again, it make your ideas keep in mind. It will ingrain in your mind by repeating the same sound. So you have to read all these texts you forget time and again. When you are on your rooftop in this epidemic, in this crisis period, don't worry and don't buy panic, because day by day you are learning something, you are getting something new. So keep them learn and try to create a notebook. What you have learned, try and open the book, write and keep remembering. So repetition is the most important thing. And in which room you stay, just make some placard by writing the author names, their themes, etc. etc. So people will call you mad, but after all, one day will get nettled straight.
Okay, Bapin, you continue, please. I think there is no more question. So if you have any question,
there is another question.
Hello, sir.
Can I raise?
Hello, sir. I got another question, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, there is another problem. So whenever I'm just writing an exam, suppose I'm writing an exam of NET, and they used to set a passage over there. We had to read and understand, and we had to answer some questions. But at the time, during the times of exams, my brain got stopped working. Whenever I was just reading that passage, I couldn't understand a single line. So what should I do? I don't know exactly what the reason of mine, but whenever I'm just taking the exam hall, at the times if I read some passages over there, I couldn't understand what I'm reading.
No, actually, I think you are a bit serious on these exams. So don't take it seriously. Take it cool, in a cool manner. So be happy and be cool. Be stress-free. I hope it will work. Don't take it in a different manner. I mean, in a don't buy penny. Okay. This is the most important thing.
Would you like to suggest anything to us for this preparation, for this passage section?
Preparation, you have to...
Am I audible?
Yeah. You have to prepare, you have to read 6 hours a day. And what I have said, one by one, step by step. Okay.
No, sir, I'm not asking about this. I'm asking about the passages that used to be come, and the way they used to ask questions. For that, I was asking that, would you like to suggest anything that how would prepare for these sections?
No, you have to prepare all, you have to read out all these texts. Otherwise, there is no shortcut here. Without any hard preparation, there is no way of shortcut.
Sir, I feel you are missing my point. I'm just asking for the passage sections that we are asked in examination. I'm to read this passage and I'm to ask, answer. Do you like to suggest anything to prepare for this section?
I'm not getting you clear. Can you please, anyone can message me this?
Mujibur Rahman, please write your question. Mujibur Rahman, please write your question on chat box. Your voice is not clear. Okay.
Sir.
Thank
sir,
you.
Sir, I'm interrupting, yeah. But I think I have understood his question. I think he wants to know that he is a little worried about the passage section that comes in NET examination. And he wants suggestions regarding that, as if how he should prepare and what are the things that he should keep in mind I think he needs suggestions specifically on the passage section that comes in NET examination.
Yes, you are right.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. So for passage section, you have to read it twice, not once. Twice or thrice. And after reading once, directly go into the question section. Okay. See the questions. Then once again, read the passage section. Another time, third time, if you can't solve it, read another time. But don't try to get it in a hurried manner. Go to the question, understand it, and solve it in your own way. Passage section is not difficult. It's an easier one. Okay. So I hope I have cleared the question. And one person asked me one question, that expressionism. I'm just came to my mind the thought that expressionism is a kind of movement that was originated during the early 20th century, and it rejected realism and presented a personal or subjective vision. Yeah. So this is how expressionism related to, you can call the drama the August Strindberg, the dream play, Lulu, plays like Lulu, Pandora's Box, all these things are there. Okay. So expressionism is a different thing from total Dadaism, or you can call it surrealism or surrealism. Okay, thank you very much. I hope Bapin, now time has come to call.
Yeah. So thank you so much. Thank you, Professor Ali, for delivering such wonderful lecture. And I am sure that this lecture will be crucial for the aspirants of NET and SET. And I also like to raise the question, not the question, rather, I just want to know from you one thing regarding surrealism. It is often said that, irrationality is the best way to express reality. This kind of statements is associated with that kind of movement called surrealism. So, will you please say something regarding this notion of irrationality? Do you think that irrationality can be the best way to express reality? How far is it possible?
See. The surrealists tried to illustrate the working of the unconscious mind in their artistic and literary creations, dreams, hallucinations, their representations and interpretation were of special interest to the surrealist, and they constructed a close analysis of dreams and hallucinations which originated in the unconscious, could take the critic beyond the real and into the realm of super real. Surrealists rejected existing artistic conventions and explored the wide variety of literary experiments. And some of the prominent writers, surrealist painters, are Henri Masson, Salvador Dali, René Magritte, Henri Breton, Paul Oulart. So this is a movement in art and literature that developed in France from Dadaism during 1920s. Henri Breton brought out the first of the three manifestos of surrealism in 1924, where he emphasized the importance of freeing the mind from tyranny of logic and reason. I hope I have cleared it.
Yeah. Professor Ali, one thing that I would like to know, that is, how can we contextualize this kind of expression to that of romantic theory, that is, spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings? Do you think that the notion that was propounded by Wordsworth, spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings, that is linked with the very notion of irrationality to express reality? That I actually want to know. This is actually I want to know from you your observation, your view on it.
What
do you think?
this can I don't know. I have to think of the, I have to think sure. on this. Without thinking, I can't declare this.
Sure.
So give me some time to think.
Definitely. I'll call you. I'll thank you. We can discuss on it.
It's a very good question. It's a very good question. And I'm humble. And I'm really overwhelmed to knowing this question. Thank you, Papin, very much.
Thank you, Professor Ali, for giving such a wonderful lecture. And one thing that I would like to mention, and I am very much pleased to hear that you are giving NetSet coaching and free of cost. That is very crucial for the time being. And it is really very, very good work that you are working. And now I would like to switch this space to Mahmudul Hasan Dabak for giving the vote of thanks to you.
So,
Hasan.
Thank you, Bapin. Professor Nargis Ahmed, Madam, Assistant Professor of Jadavpur Aliya University, will deliver the vote of thanks. So it is over to you, Nargis, Madam.
Thank you. Good evening to all of you present here. I must thank BASE for giving opportunity to deliver vote of thanks today. On behalf of BASE, Bengali Academia for Social Empowerment, I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to our today's speaker, esteemed speaker, Sheikh Sagir Ali, Assistant Professor, Midnapur College, for his very important and informative lecture today, which is on NetSet is Easy, a study of English language and literature. And I believe, sir, your lecture was important as well as very much informative as maximum participants we have observed joined today. And I believe that they have got real help from your lecture. Thank you so much, sir, for your deliberation, kind deliberation today. You made them understand that there is no shortcut. And at the same time, you sprinkle the ray of hope that if they work hard, definitely they will get this in future.
Yeah, there is no shortcut to success. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I would like to thank Bapin Malik, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar College, Nodia, for coordinating today's session very well, as well as he briefed also the whole session very well. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank BASE President, Vice President, GS, and all members who are constantly working, actively working day and night for this lecture series happening successfully. Thank you all. And last but not the least, I must thank our valuable and lovely participants who are constantly being with us in all lecture series. They are there and they have shown their real interest in BASE lecture series. So thank you all once again. Our next lecture is lecture number 23. Topic is Engineering Education in India, Trends and Future Directions by Professor Dr. Abdul Samad, Department of Ocean Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Chennai. It will be on 29th July, 7:30 p.m. onwards. So thanks. Thank you all once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Nargis Ahmed, Madam. So, I would request to every participant to leave this session. So it's now over now. And thank you, Sagir, again.
Thank you.
Okay.